Hey, everybody. This is a 1/64th scale model. It's a die-cast car. It's a 1949 Mercury. My dad had a car that looked a lot like this. The manufacturer of this car did a good job recreating the car in this small scale. Let's use a 10 times magnification and take a closer look. Mercury. Yeah, the detail is pretty good. I'd say for this scale, it's exceptional. This is a 1965 Dodge A100 van. It's good detail. Very nice. Very, very nice. Now, I got this out. This 10 times magnifier. It's got a 21 millimeter element in it. Because I wanted to show you a very fine detail on some pens. Before I do, I'm going to take a sip of nice, cool water. I mean, it's frosty. just a piece of wood, just a block. And it's got a wood screw kind of started. I don't recall if I've ever shown you these before. This is a screwdriver that my grandfather made himself. He actually made two of them. They're both flathead screwdrivers, and one is slightly larger than the other. Now, what's unique about these is the handles. It's a very interesting maroon colored handle. I thought about polishing the handles and polishing this steel, but I chose not to. My grandfather was a tool and die maker for Parker Pen for most of his career. I think he went to work for Parker Pen in the early 20s, 1920s. And he stayed there until he retired. Now he's no longer with us, but he left my dad these screwdrivers. And now they belong to me. I imagine my grandfather probably removed these screwdrivers as needed on a fairly regular basis each day at work. And used them and worked with him. And made a living for his family. I don't know if he ever envisioned that his grandson would someday be using them in front of, I don't know, 20, 30, 40,000 people. This is really not the best screwdriver for this type of screw. Though the screw is slotted and Phillip head. You can use either type, but Phillip head screws generally are better than flathead screws. And Phillip head screwdrivers are usually better suited for turning a screw into a block of wood. I just wanted to show you guys these. I've been pretty fascinated with these. Ever since he came into my possession. Which was before I developed an interest in fountain pens. Actually, well, my interest in fountain pens came not too long after I got the screwdrivers. I've got a book right here. I wanted to show you something in this book. So I need to readjust the camera. Okay. Let me move this out of the way. So my aunt worked at Parker Pen also. And there's a man, Paul Arano, that published this book on fountain pens. This is a signed copy. And this was my aunt. It was her book. You've probably seen some of my, at least one or two Matchbook Collection videos. In those videos, I was showcasing some of my aunt's matchbooks that she collected. Now, this is a very good book, and I'm not going to sit there and show it to you because the guy that published it might prefer that you go out and actually buy the book. So, and, you know, without his permission, I can't show you the book. But I do want to show you just one page, and I have it marked. Now, years ago, I was looking at this book, and a particular pen jumped out at me. Make one small adjustment on the camera. Here we go. It was this pen in particular. Turn the book sideways and give you a better look. You see the material that the pen is made out of. Kind of looks like this. And it is, it's the same exact material. Back in the 30s and 40s, Parker Pen made a line of pens they called a Vacumatic. And they made them out of that out of that material. I'm drawing a blank on it. Let me think for just a second. Yeah, it's celluloid. That's what it is. It's a clear celluloid alternating with a kind of a pearlescent celluloid. I think that was as far as I know, it was Parker Pen only. This was their material, I guess. So I found those to be quite fascinating, and that's when I became interested in Parker Vacumatics. I think they came on the market in the early 30s, 33, 34, somewhere right around there. Before they called them the Vacumatic, I think they called them the Parker Golden Arrow or something like that, because of the new Arrow pocket clip that they began to put on them. So, lucky for me, passed down to me from my dad, and probably he got them from his dad, were a nice collection of Vacumatics. Here's one in maroon. There's the Golden Arrow clip. But yeah, you can see there's no doubt that my grandfather used some of this material and made these screwdrivers when he was at work at Parker. Okay, I made a small adjustment on the camera. But this maroon pen is probably the most sought after color. It's the hardest one to find. This one has a matching pencil. I can still write with it. It's got lead in it. Parker Vacumatic. And the maroon is nice and all, but if you know me, and some of you do, it's no surprise to you that green is the color of my choice. This pen is pretty much a work of art, in my opinion. They produce these pens through the 40s and into the, well, I think, I'm trying to remember. Let me think real hard for a second. Yeah, I think it was 1948 was the last year you could buy these American-made. These pens that you see in front of you here, in front of me, I should say, were manufactured in Janesville, Wisconsin. There's a Parker plant in Canada that continued to make these until 1953, I believe. Boy, that nib is dirty. I need to clean this pen. Here's a blue one. It's pretty stunning. That might match the blue in my watch. I don't know. Yeah, that's close. Well, if you're wondering about the watch, it's an inexpensive watch that my wife got for me. I mentioned that I'd like to have a new watch, that I just didn't want to buy it. And 2 or 3 weeks later, she had bought 4 watches at one time for me. This is one of them. Yeah, that blue is stunning. Here's some golden colored one. I've actually got 2 of these gold. I can't think of what this color is called, but I have 2 of these. This one was given to me by my daughter-in-law. Her grandmother passed away. This was, I think she found this in her grandmother's house. Parents said she could have it, I guess, and she gave it to me. It has a broken clip. It has a nib that needs cleaned also. See, these nibs are solid gold. And they're supposed to be shiny. As solid gold should be. This one has the blue diamond on the clip. Which is different than my green one. Blue diamond. No blue diamond. My grandfather made the tooling to make these clips. He did other things too. He worked on prototypes. A lot of times he worked in part of the machine shop. They wouldn't let anybody come around him because of the nature of what he was working on. It was top secret designs. Now you can tell when one of these pens was manufactured because they put a marking on them, a date marking. They put the For 1945, the pen had a little microscopic 5. And then they would also tell you which quarter the pen was produced in. You know, first, second, third, or fourth quarter. And the marking is it's on the barrel. Right after where it says made in USA. Let me see how close we can get to that down here. Maybe I can show that to you. Let me pull back on the zoom. I'm going to try really hard to show this. Okay, this one was made in the first quarter of 1938. Let me play with the focus just a little bit. You see, I can't let the camera focus itself, you know, on autofocus, because it makes a very minute, high-pitched beeping noise. It's very irritating. So I have to manually focus each time I set up a shot. So where'd it go? Where did it go? Okay, there's the words. I don't think I can get any better than what I had. It looks like an 18, but that's a 1, and that means first quarter. And the 8 means 38. Let's look at the green one. Now, on this one, I see a 7 and a dot. And this is a slightly different way of marking it, but the 7 the 7 means 1947. And one dot means the fourth quarter, because the way the stamping die was set, if it had three dots, that would be the first quarter. And then in the second quarter, they would grind away one of the dots. So if you had two dots, it would be the second quarter. And if you only had one dot, that would be the third quarter. And then going into the fourth quarter, they would grind away the last dot. And the fourth quarter would have no dots. So, maybe that's too much info. I don't know. Whoops. You see, this one appears to be, where'd it go? A 5 and two dots. So that's going to be 1945 and the second quarter. Yeah, that's the way that works. And let's look at one more. first we need to find the writing. There it is. You see it says, Parker Vacumatic, made in USA, and this one has a 5 and 2 dots, or is that a 6? It's really hard to say. Let's say it's a 6. So that would be 1946. Second quarter. Now you might be wondering, how do you know it's 46 instead of 36? Because after all, I did say that Parker started making these in the early 30s. Well, I can tell because of the style of pen. This particular standard, I got some ink on me. This standard style had this particular type of blind cap in this plastic filler on it. This is what they used in the later days. The pen, the maroon pen, has a different blind cap. With a different type of filler. This has what you call a, I think they call it a lockdown filler. It's metal. It's got a little notch in it, so after you push it, you can rotate it and lock it down so that it can't come back out. Because if you don't do that, you can't get the cap on it. It's the filler's too tall unless you lock it down. So what I wanted to do I have this bottle of Parker ink. It's called a Quink. Parker Quink. I've never wrote with this one. I wanted to go ahead and write with it. So we have to fill it. You don't really have to shake up ink, but I always do. I just like the way it sounds. After all, this is an ASMR channel. So, the way you do this is you unlock it, and then you put it into the ink up to about here, and then just push this several times to put ink in it. It is so old. What did I say this one was? 37? 38, I already forget. First quarter, 1938. Wow. The pen is what? 80 something years old. Pushing that button. Now before I lock it down, I'm going to hold it over the jar and push the button and lock it down. Yeah, just as I suspected when I did that, several drops of ink came out. There it goes. Let's put the blind cap on it. Do a very quick cleanup, and now before I do anything else, we're gonna put the cap back onto the jar. Because if I knock this over, it will ruin my day. I'm going to put the cap on it. I prefer to write with a cap on. That's called posting the pen. This is unposted. That's posted. I'm going to zoom in on this a little bit. Parker Vacumatic. That's right, something. Let's write a list of the greatest athletes of, I don't know, modern time, you know, at least the last 100 years anyway. That looked funny. Let's just start over. That looks better. I've got a list in front of me. Just gonna copy it, basically. I'm not gonna tell you where it came from. It's just something off the internet. And you might not agree with all the different names, or you might not care. We'll start this off with number one. It says Michael Jordan. This pen it's kind of scratchy. He played basketball. And he played some baseball too, but I think I'm gonna write this entire list, but I'm gonna do it in a separate video. All right, one more here. Babe Ruth. Baseball. This nib is very fine. Very fine nib. Yeah, so we're going to end this video here. I'm going to write this list in my next video. It's just going to be just a writing video. And when this car, not the toy, but the real one, was new in 49, these pens were being used during that time. And the thing about a fountain pen is you didn't buy it and treat it roughly and throw it away. You know, like disposable pens of today. You bought one of these and you used it for decades. That's just the way it was. Let me take another sip of water.